Okay, well, I'll start like everybody else does. I would like to thank the organizers and Richard for having me invited, and use the usual disclaimer about what I will say does not reflect the view of LCH. Being an independent director is not the same as being an independent variable in statistics, but might not also reflect the views of University of Paris too, who doesn't really care about what I'm going to say today. So, what I've tried to do here is to spot where are the weak links in central clearing functioning in terms of consequences that they might have in systemic risk. Because as Richard pointed out, CCPs are crucial in the functioning of the financial architecture because all the flows are going to be concentrated there. Now, if we just look at the numbers about the size of CCP measured by assets, remember the non-bank financial intermediation world is about $160 trillion, as estimated by the FSB report, the last one. CCPs belong to the subsectors of OFI, called OFI, yeah, other financial institution, which accounts for $99 trillion. Now, when you measure the CCP size by their assets, then they account for 0.4 trillion. Which would tend to lead us to think that they're quite negligible, they're very small in size. But they are of systemic importance because they offer those critical services. Now, so if you look in terms of individual size, they're important. Because it's the same issues when you think in terms of concentration. So the CCP sector is highly concentrated. There's also lots of interconnectedness that's involved and complexity. Now, if we look at the concentration aspect, just to give you a rough idea, you have one CCP that clears about $1 trillion a day. So the flows, in terms of flows, they are critical. Now, concentration is still a trend in the financial industry. I mean, concentration, you have it in the banking sector, of course, more or less depending on which part of the world you're looking at, but it's a trend in the asset management business. If you look at the first three asset managers, they have $10,000 billion under management. So if you combine this with an increased increasing share of passive management strategies, one can understand the consequences you'd have in terms of financial stability when one of these major asset managers decides to sell a given public debt for a given country. They can be destabilizing. If we look at the concentration, do I have it here a little bit? Yeah. Well, if you look at the concentration trend for CCPs, you have a fabulous report from FBIS, FSB, CPIM from August 18 on the central clearing interdependencies. You'll have all the information you want. But you see that the two largest CCPs in terms of pre-funded financial resources account for 40% of the total pre-funded resources for the CCPs. So for some product, as Richard pointed out, they are quasi-monopolies. For instance, in Europe, interest rate swaps are cleared at 90% through only one CCP. okay, that clears, that cleared last year $850 trillion in notional. So of course this results from the increasing level of clearing derivatives, OTC derivatives, and if you compare the level of clearing in 2009, only less than a quarter of OTC derivatives were cleared, where now we're approaching interest rates, swaps, now we're approaching 62%. So in the US, if you look at in the US, you'd have more or less the same thing, that is the CME that clears most futures contract, OCC clears most of the option contracts, or ICE clears most of the CDSs. So there's lots of concentration and quasi-monopolies in some instances. Now, you can understand why there's this concentration occurs. The functioning of netting positions is subject as to economies of scales and to network effects. That's obvious. So now if we look at the interconnection, well, post-crisis regulation achieved to mitigate some interconnectedness between banks, mainly with the obligation to clear OTC derivatives in CCPs. Okay, and again, remember interest rate swaps, for those who are not too familiar, they're about $300 trillion of notional, even if they've come down. Now, the drawback that comes from this obligation of clearing is that the interconnection between banks and CCP has increased. To a lesser extent, the interconnection between banks and asset management has asset managers has also increased. Lots of reason, as you know, but one would be, for instance, the growth of synthetic ETFs, which increases the link between asset managers and investment banks, or the fact that asset managers don't always have a direct access to CCPs, and they clear through banks, so interconnections. So it seems that when you don't measure only with the asset side, interconnection has somewhat shifted from within the banking sector to banks, non-banks, right? Yeah, that's fine. So if you look at some other numbers, what you would see is that, for instance, one CCP clears for 29 systemic financial institutions. Okay, seven CCPs clear for at least 16 globally systemic financial institutions. Okay, so you have those interconnections between CCPs and CFIs that have increased. There's been a reallocation of interconnectedness, but propagation and amplification channels are still in the financial system, and we should still be worried. Another way of looking at it is saying that, I'm lost, sorry. 11 of the largest clearing members out of more than 300, let's say, are connected to between 16 and 25 CCPs. Okay, and when I say large clearing member, we use the measure, the size, by pre-funded financial resources. So what happens when one of these largest clearing member, which is bound to be a SIFI, defaults? Well, it will probably default in all the other CCPs too. Even, yeah, it will probably. So you see the propagation mechanism is there. Then the second problem is that there are amplification loops. clearing members are very often members that are service providers. They provide custody services, settlement services, credit liquidity facilities, cash and non-investment cash. So if a big member defaults and is also a service provider, then the CCP is impacted both ways. Yeah, so it's even worse. So another problem is linked to the procyclicality of margins and haircuts. Now, you know that most collateral is either cash or government bonds, so any sovereign debt crisis has a big impact on margin calls. Article 41 of EMIR set out requirement for CCPs to monitor the procyclicality arising from margin revisions and margin parameters. So CCPs have to adopt at least one of the three anti-procyclicality margin measures related to volatility estimates, because volatility estimates are key to prevent erosion of margin levels during quiet periods, which would generate an sharp procyclical correction where markets condition to change. So the three choices in volatility estimates are either you take a 10-year look back period, which is a bit concerning now because we're 10 years away from the big financial crisis or the big mess of September or autumn 2018. So what, 2008, sorry. Now, some exchanges have decided to just drop that crisis scenario because we're moving on, and some other exchanges will still keep it. So, see, the risk is not managed the same. The other two choices they have in volatility estimates is either put a 25 weight to stress observation in the look-back period, or put margin buffers of at least 25% of calculated margin, okay? So here you introduce discrepancies between CCPs, and we had some issues in CCPs, all around CCPs, after the Italian elections when the 2-year government bond spread surge for more than 200 basis points. You can imagine that, you know, you wanted to increase some margins. Oh, I forgot to show you a beautiful graph that I really liked in that report I mentioned. That's the graph of interdependencies between CCPs, which are in red, and clearing members that provide services. So again, it comes from the same report I mentioned, and I think, yes, this graph is better than a long speech. Now, questions for policymakers, because time is going. So, and then I will go back to Richard when he says, you know, what's the optimal shareholder structure, because they tend to be monopolies, they're utilities and recognized as such, they're too important to fail, definitely they should be public entities. Yeah, well, if you go on, you know, if you read Daryl Duffy, he says there should be only one CCP and around the world. So, I mean, it's not, you know, it's not obvious. Of course, you could wonder if they should be totally private or if they should be owned by their users, like DTCC is, and DTCC is still efficient. But what you notice is you have either a silo structure or horizontal structure. The silo structure is preferred, as for example in Germany, Eurex is known clear. CCP is owned by Eurex. Usually it's the markets that own the CCP, with one exception in the US being DTCC and in Europe being LCH, where some users are also shareholders. But that is really an issue. Anyway, there are conflicts of interest everywhere, and we know that public entities are not always the most efficient ones, as we have learned in France with the Crédit Lyonnais default, which was a public bank. So being public is not always optimal, right? What I think policymakers should focus on is to how to mitigate the interconnection between clearing members and service providers. Okay, like CCPs should deal only with CSDs or have credit line with central banks and not with other banks, because if a clearing bank is a member and that same clearing bank provides you with credit line and that bank defaults, what are you going to do? You can't use those credit lines anymore. So, and that's why some CCPs are very happy to, well, in some ways, are happy to have the status of a bank. So there are, so some of them are banks, like LCHSA, well, weird banks. And then because they're banks, they have direct access and direct liquidity access with the central bank. Otherwise, you have to negotiate some agreement with the central bank. But we have a Brexit issue here, for instance. What's going to happen when the Bank of England, which has guaranteed some liquidity in euros to British CCPs, what happens when the Brexit occurs? Do they still have the swaps agreement between central banks? I mean, we don't know, we don't want to know. And then we have so, and along the lines, you know, should we be, I mean, should governments be granting more licenses or foster consolidation on CCPs because there are economies of scale, because risk management is very sophisticated and you need lots of IT input, and so it costs a lot. And we do see that small CCPs are more, seem more risky than others, okay? For example, you mentioned one CCP, which everybody knows, it was a newspaper, it was NASDAQ Electricity, with the problem that occurred, almost failed. Well, they had, as a clearing member, an independent trader. Yes, very rich, but an independent trader, which in the end turned out not to be rich enough. Well, this could not occur like in France, where you're not allowed to have individuals being clearing members. Okay, so those are issues to be looking at. And then there's another, it's not equivalence or interoperability. What I meant is, in the process of giving equivalence licenses, then you're introducing an uneven playing field simply because CCPs are not managed the same way. In some CCPs, haircuts have a floor, which is linked to the ECB floor on haircuts. In some CCPs, the haircuts are much smaller than those used by the central bank. So it appears more risky. And then you have a choice of a system where you have preferred CCP within a trade, or you introduce interoperability between CCPs. Interoperability seems to be a trend because it's more flexible, but I would say looking at it from the systemic point of view, it increases propagation. Because if one CCP defaults and has links with, is interoperable with five other CCPs, then the other five other CCPs are in a situation. Okay, so there are lots more questions we could ask, but I think I'm running out of time. Sorry. Thank you.